Hi, I'm Dr. John Bennett. Continuing the broadcast from Miami, Florida, we have another talk in the series of the topic of brain tumors for the online channel of neurosurgical.tv. We have the pleasure of having Ahmed Al Jishi, MD, a neurosurgeon that practiced mostly in Montreal. I believe he's in Hamilton now, and he'll tell you about his background. And first, we'll introduce the guest. First, from Croatia. Slaven.
Hello, everyone. My name is Slaven Gojković. I'm very pleased and glad to be here, so it is truly an honor. I'm looking forward to the presentation.
Thank you, Slaven. And Simon.
Hello, everyone. Thank you once again for inviting me here. I'm really looking forward to Ahmed's presentation. I'm in Japan.
Welcome, Simon. And welcome, Ahmed. It's all yours.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks. John, for having me for presenting at your neurosurgical channel. It's really an honor to be around and share part of our practice and as well as knowledge. So my background, I'm actually practicing as a neurosurgeon, and I graduated from McGill University. I studied there my neurosurgery program, followed by pediatric and neurosurgery. I was supposed to start right after to practice my pediatric and neurosurgery, but then I decided to complete that with a spine training, and that actually opened me another avenue to start practicing. That's why right now I'm in Hamilton, working at McMaster University for a neurosurgical job. I'm handling brain cases, spine cases, pain complex cases as well. So it's been tough so far.
Wow, that sounds amazing.
Very, very good. I appreciate you giving a talk outside of your spine and pediatric area. And today you're going to talk about choroid plexus tumors.
Do you want me to start now?
Yes, please.
Right, sure. So, okay, so I'd like to start with a case. Let me know if there's any time where you don't see me, but that I can just back up.
Okay.
So I'd like to start with a case. So this is a 6 years old boy that we had came to the emergency department with a 2 week history with the headache and worsening gait. When we saw him in exam, he was actually awake and alert, but it was very clear that he was in distress. He was holding his head and crying. His vital signs were all within normal, and on exam he was also having papilledema. There was no focal neurological deficit, actually, except for having him with ataxic gait. He had an MRI that actually showed an evidence of a space-occupying lesion. And as you can see in those sequences, that this lesion appeared to be something within the ventricles, and it is associated with vasogenic edema. It's kind of having the lobulated pattern, and I would say this patient was having a heterogeneous kind of enhancements post-gadolinium, as you can see in those images. So this patient underwent a surgery, and the surgery actually was quite difficult because of the bloody nature of that tumor. So all this cavity had got, been cleaned from the tumor with a little bit of a tumor that left here. So the pathology came as a choroid plexus papilloma, and the fact that this patient has a remnant of a tumor, chemotherapy was initiated. So dealing with choroid plexus tumors is actually very challenging compared to other tumors that we face in the brain, considering the fact nowadays we are having neural navigation, lots of meticulous skills available to do all kinds of exposure for the brain. But once you are within the ventricle, it's actually a different world, and you're going to see that as I go with my presentation. So the choroid plexus tumors are unique intraventricular tumors for a couple of reasons. Number one, their origin. They originate from the choroid plexus, so you may see them originating from the lateral ventricles, coming from the third ventricle, or sometime also from the fourth ventricle, or an extension from there. they basically follow the course of those choroid plexus, considering their origin. Choroid plexus, and as you're going to see from the talk, they are tied up to essential neural and vascular structures, so it's, that makes it challenging to remove, and that actually gives them the high vascularity. They may occlude the CSF, so the patient may not present with symptoms of the tumor, but rather with entrapment of the ventricles causing hydrocephalus. Sometimes they might be active to secrete lots of CSF that can be up to 800 ml per day, compared to 150 volume that will occupy our brain every hour. And they can be benign and they can be malignant. So as an outline, I'm going to give a brief introduction considering the time, clinical presentation, pathological description, as well as corridors or avenues for managing those patients and outcome study. I don't have any conflicts of interest. Choroid plexus tumors are rare tumors. They constitute around 1% or less for all intracranial tumors, but they are quite common, relatively speaking, compared to adults in pediatric age groups. When you look at that group of pediatrics, most of the time you're going to see them below the age of 2 years, but during infancy, it was actually also common to see them between 10 to 20%. They derived from specialized neuroepithelial cells, which are the choroid plexus, and actually surgery had shown to play an essential role in the treatment of such tumors. Those patients, they don't have any special or specific symptomatology when they present. So they do present with symptoms of high intracranial pressure, nausea, vomiting, blurred vision. They may also have seizures. But sometimes when they are localizing within structures that will compress over motor cortex, for instance, or close to visual apparatus or within the posterior fossa, they may present with symptoms that will allocate the lesion, but not necessarily as a choroid plexus tumor. Typically, they do present with a short-term duration of symptoms, considering when they enlarge to a significant size or secrete lots of CSF. However, in infancy, they may present with increased head circumference or split sutures. In terms of location, the majority of them, they are within the lateral ventricles compared to the third, fourth, as well as more than one ventricles. Rare locations will be outside of the intraventricular space, can be around the basal cisterns, supracellular cistern, or the CP angle. So between the age duration up to 9 years old, they are actually presenting most of the time in the supratentorial compartment, but as the time goes, they might be above or below the tentorium. So this is just some images to depict the location of those tumors, and you can see this is a space-occupying lesion within the fourth ventricle, that they can be in the third ventricle to result in significant hydrocephalus, or they might be within one part of the ventricle, which is the atrium, but not actively secreting or releasing CSF. They can be also coming out here of the foramen of Loschka. On CT scan, which I don't have an image here, they might show some calcification in 10% of them. But once the lesion become heterogeneous or having some cystic degeneration, you will think about a high-grade tumor. This is just an MRI, so image A match with C and image B match with D, and you can see that the tumor in A has a lobulated pattern with a homogeneously enhancing mass after gadolinium injection, compared to, and this is a choroid plexus papilloma. Looking at B and D, you can see that we're losing that pattern of lobulation along with some cystic degeneration, and that's an example of choroid plexus carcinoma. People sometimes use MRI spectroscopy, and typically speaking, both of them, they have a reduction in the N-acetyl aspartate, as you can see in those spectroscopies. But with papilloma, you might see myo-inositol peak, which is absent actually in choroidal plexus papilloma, but it is absent in choroidal plexus carcinoma. But in comparison, you will see a significant choline peak. This is just to help diagnosis before intervening. However, this is not the only tumor that can happen at this location. You should be aware about possible differential diagnoses that include ependymoma, germinoma, teratoma, PNET, ATRT, astrocytoma, and meningioma. When you look at the pathology of those tumors, so there is an entity here that up to now the pathologist cannot say if this is a tumor or not. It's just a growing of that choroidal plexus. They call it choroidal plexus hypertrophy. Histologically, they look the same in terms of papillary pattern and having the cuboidal cells, but it doesn't reach the level of having it a choroidal plexus papilloma, where you will see a nuclear leomorphism and moderate celularity and rare mitoses. When you come to the atypical, this entity we call it WHO grade 1. When you come to the atypical choroidal plexus papilloma, which is grade 2, it still preserves the papillary pattern, but you're going to see a higher celularity in comparison to the low-grade papilloma. But one specific finding histologically is that you will have two or more mitoses per 10 to the high power field. Choroidal plexus carcinoma, that papillary pattern will be significantly lost along with loss of the supporting fibrous stroma, and you will see evidence of higher mitoses, necrosis, and giant cell formation. This is just to show you how the choroidal plexus papilloma, so in A and B, this is the normal choroidal plexus pattern. Okay, so you can see a papillary pattern along with the cuboidal cells. Cells seem to be all homogeneous. But when you look at CND, which is a choroidal plexus papilloma, you will see that relatively there is a dense packed cells, right? An anaplasia that might be also present, but you don't see any evidence of mitosis, for example. Normally, S100 and low molecular weight keratin will be positive in any choroidal plexus, so it has to be positive for normal and also abnormal. But what makes it a tumor is that when you see an evidence of GFAP and CEA, which unfortunately I don't have an image for it now. When you go to a higher grade, which is WHO grade 2 atypical choroid plexus papilloma, that papillary pattern will be relatively preserved, but the cells obviously looks abnormal compared to the previous slide. When you go to the choroid plexus carcinoma, that pattern is completely lost, loss of fibrous stromal cells, and also a significant positive immunohistochemistry with the GFAP. How do we manage those patients? Obviously, those patients are coming with high intracranial pressure, so we need to address that by making sure that the head is elevated to 30 or 40 degrees, maintain a good saturation of oxygen saturation. Consider EVD only if needed, because hydrocephalus in those patients might be a key in having the proper approach, as you're going to see in the upcoming slides. VP shunt is not routinely recommended for the aforementioned reason. When you consider doing surgery for those patients, you should know that you require lots of knowledge about the ventricular and paraventricular anatomy. So it's actually challenging, and you will actually reach a point where you need to outline your surgical goals of that in terms of what is the safe surgical access to get that tumor out, and you need to be aware about that access and potential neurological compromise that may happen. And for those kind of tumors, obtaining a vascular control is quite essential. Some patients may require a preoperative embolization, considering the location and the complexity of the of that choroidal plexus tumor. Now, how do we get to those tumors, and how can we resect them? So the surgeon needs to study those images quite efficiently in order to decide whether you're going to go through the brain, which is transcortical, are you going to go subfrontal, interhemispheric, or suboccipital. Let's look at those approaches. So this is some illustration from Roton anatomy book, and you can see it's actually different avenues to reach the ventricles that will actually determine the patient position. Are you going to go from the back in the trigone, or when you're going to go in the front, are you going to go underneath or the ventricle or through the ventricles? Are you going to come from the temporal horn? So it's quite complex, actually, when you come to approach such lesions. This is another depiction here, and actually, this is one of my favorite, that you can see that you can access the ventricle from everywhere, but that doesn't mean that each approach work for any single location, but rather it deals with the location of the tumor itself. So let's take some anatomy slides here. So when you look at structure A, so the surgeon, when he or she comes through this approach, she needs to know that you're having the caudate nucleus here when you approach. Considering to when you go more posterior, you will start to encounter more structures here. For example, you have the fornix, which deals with the memory, and also the thalamus, which is, as everybody knows, is a relay center for the rest of the body. Injuring the thalamus may result in contralateral hemiplegia, for instance. When you go to C, you're actually dealing with lots of crossing fibers from that aspect. And also, you will deal with the crossing fibers that deals with the vision as well. And crossing D, there is what we call the Myers lobe. So you need also to be aware about the location of that in order to prevent a contralateral quadranopsia. Another drawing here. So when we come as surgeons, and I want you to look at this side, you will basically see the choroid plexus, and this is basically the thalamus. What Dr. Roton did here is actually he draws the vessels that comes in the vicinity, and every surgeon who goes for this approach, he needs to put those vessels in mind. You're not going to see any of those vessels actually except for the medial choroidal vessels, as you're going to see in the upcoming slides. It's also quite essential to be familiar with the venous anatomy. Patient who got injury to any of those veins may actually screw your outcome, and the patient may wake up with significant deficit, and you're going to see that in the upcoming slides. Let's go through the first approach. This is the interhemispheric approach. It's actually one of my favorite, though it's complex, but sometimes it's good to face some challenges. So here, this is the front, this is the back, and this is basically the superior sagittal sinus being retracted. We don't see all that when we operate our patients. We actually see one part of it. This is the fossa being retracted, and obviously at this area, we're retracting over the paracentral area. So surgeon needs to be quite even with this retraction, because you may injure the motor cortex, and patient may wake up with contralateral weakness. So it's actually a small corridor at the end. You can see also that the first thing that comes here is the anterior cerebral arteries, and you need to watch those, obviously. Then you will get the corpus callosum. If the tumor is located within the one ventricle, you may just go through the corpus callosum, and then you will find this nice anatomy. So here you will have to identify the fornix, and which deals with the memory, and this is the choroid plexus, and it actually separates the thalamus from the fornix. And then you will see this nice vein, which is called thalamus raiate vein, which separates the thalamus from the caudate nucleus. If you get to injure the thalamus raiate vein, the patient will develop a venous infarction in the thalamus if there was no other alternative venous drainage. another view here, which is actually important to identify this anatomy, especially when you go with tube-assisted procedures, which is coming actually more common nowadays. Again, this is the foramen of Monroe. This is the body of the fornix, and then you will see the turn of that cross. This is the anterior septal vein, and this is the thalamostriate vein. Again, remember, the thalamostriate vein separates the thalamus from the caudate nucleus. This is the superior choroidal vein, which, and you can see how the choroid plexus tied up with those veins, which makes it actually challenging when the tumor originates from here. Sometimes the tumor is coming from the third ventricle, and some surgeon would love to go through the choroidal fissure, and this is another dissection that Dr. Roton did to dissect through the choroidal fissure, and you can see now those medial posterior choroidal vessels, which actually wasn't seen before. And this is the internal cerebral vein that will go eventually to vein of Galen, or the great cerebral vein. Now, this approach is actually a continuation of the interhemispheric fissure if you are actually approaching the third ventricle. In this, you need to split each fornix. And just to depict that for you, that's the cross of the fornix. So the body of the fornix is actually within this retractor. So even with your retraction, you need to be careful because you're retracting both fornices, and that will actually impact your outcome with memory. So once you get to split, or we call it interseptal approach, you will be able to go through the interpositum, and the structures there will be basically the internal cerebral vein, medial choroidal vessels, and then you are within the third ventricle. This is how it looks, and actually you can see it's actually also complex because you still see the fornices that you need to protect from memory. This is the anterior commissure. This is the lamina terminalis where it is safe to actually puncture if you want to release some CSF if you are coming for aneurysmal procedure, for instance. This is the chiasm. Obviously, you need to avoid that to prevent postoperative neurological deficit. This is the infundibulum, and it's going to take you right to the infundibular stock. Hypothalamus will be just to the side. Some of my mentors are actually making always a joke that hypothalamus may manifest with some deficit by just looking at it. And I think he's right with what he said. If the tumor is in the back, can we do an interhemispheric approach? Yes, you can. And the safe corridor, if you want to go to the trigone, is that you can cut through the cingulate gyrus. Again, that anatomy will be totally different, so you need always to follow those anatomical landmarks. So it's like your compass when you are in the ocean, where is north, where is the east. You need always to identify those structures. Where is the choroid plexus? Because lateral to it, going to be the thalamus. As you can see here, this is the pulvinar. This is an example of Dr. Roton's way of resection of a tumor, and you can see how vascular this area is. This is how it looks after the resection. Now, nice, challenging approach, has its own pros and cons. Some of the advantages is that you're actually not violating the cortex, you're not damaging the cortex, and you get a direct access to the ventricular system, and it is probably the best approach to choose when your patient comes with no hydrocephalus. However, you have to retract for a long time, so patient might be suffering from postoperative injury. You are encountering lots of vessels and veins, you are retracting over the fornix, so that's actually affecting the memory. So what other approaches we have then? So you have the transcortical approach. So transcortical approach, you are basically going through the brain. It's not necessarily, as you see here, as an opening in the brain, what we do in surgery, but this is just a depiction for the drawing. It's actually way smaller than this. So this is a corticectomy through the middle frontal gyrus, where, again, you're going to see the same anatomy. You need to identify choroid plexus, medially going to be the fornix, laterally going to be the thalamus. This is for sure going to be the thalamus rhaeate vein, and lateral to it going to be the caudate nucleus. Always need you need to keep that in mind. This is another approach, and I'm sure you can identify, though this is a drawing, that this is the choroidal, this is the choroid plexus. Medial to it, it should be the thalamus, it should be the fornix, but Dr. Roton here dissected already the choroidal fissure. That's why this is the fornix, and those are the internal cerebral veins, as well as the medial posterior choroidal arteries. This is an example just of a tumor. This is what actually we see, and sometimes we don't see any of that actually. So it is the responsibility of the surgeon when the tumor being resected is to try to identify the tumor as you go with the resection. And here you can see once the tumor was resected, we start to see those landmarks. That's what makes it challenging actually. I recently got to operate a patient with intraventricular tumor, we call it SEGA, which comes with tuberous sclerosis. It was actually so bloody, and I only identified my landmarks at the end of the tumor resection, but the patient did well. Now, when the tumor come in the posterior aspect, before I showed you interhemispheric approach for the posterior tumors, but this is through the trigone. Look at it, and the patient will have actually a reversed image, which makes it actually challenging for the surgeon, but nonetheless, you need to always identify those structures. So that's the choroidal plexus, so that's lateral, this is the thalamus, as you can see the depiction here with the pulvinar. Advantages. Again, it gives you a direct access, and actually probably faster than the interhemispheric approach to the interventricular tumors. You don't encounter any vessels, so you don't worry about other areas being compromised. And this is the best approach that you should consider when your patient comes with a hydrocephalus, because the ventricle is already dilating, and it will basically dissect your way to the tumor. The disadvantage of this is that you are actually damaging the cortex. So that may, for example, lead to formation of a scar and a complication from that aspect. Now, subfrontal approach. This is not a common approach for such tumors now in my mind, but this is actually an option. So when you have somebody, for example, having a tumor in the third ventricle, so you can see that this is a bicoronal approach, and this is the fox here. This is one cerebral hemisphere being retracted, and this is the area of the lamina terminalis that I showed you before from intraventricular view. So this is how it looks. So this is the chiasm here. This is the lamina terminalis after we open that, and this is the mammillary bodies. Prior, I came from the top to show you that area. So this is, before we open it, and this is how it looks afterward. It also has its own challenges because it has lots of vessels at the same time. So this is a view through the subfrontal approach for a tumor that is located inside the third ventricle with an extension into the lateral ventricle. So the tumor is being resected after Dr. Roton opened the lamina terminalis, and also get an opening through the corpus callosum, which is at this area. I know it's challenging, but the more and more you do of such cases with patient and orientation of the anatomy, you will be able to understand it. This is after the lateral ventricle being cleaned and cleared, actually. So you start to see the foramen of Monroe here, and now he's finishing the resection in the third ventricle. And note, please, that you're still having those optic apparatus and ACOM and ACA in the area. So be careful of that. So the advantages of such, tumor is that basically you're approaching the tumor itself, and I'm sorry, I think that I did some mix-up here, but there is a risk of injuring those optic nerve and the chiasm as well as pituitary stalk, but at the same time, it's an advantage that you will see it to prevent it from happening. How about the outcome? So again, this is a rare tumor. Okay, so there are few landmark studies that came to talk about this tumor. So in general, the overall survival for patients who has a choroid plexus papilloma used to be at 5 years reported around 80% versus 40%. However, one of those papers that I actually liked that came in 2009, where the outcome became better. So there was a group of almost 133 patients were divided into choroid plexus papilloma, which is WHO grade 1, choroid plexus, the atypical choroid plexus papilloma, which is the grade 2, and choroid plexus carcinoma. So in this group, patients who get a complete resection of choroid plexus papilloma were not included, and the patient who got a complete resection of the atypical form were also not included. So we are actually, or they included the atypical incomplete resection and the choroid plexus carcinoma regardless of the extent of the resection. Patients were radiated craniospinally with 35 gray, obviously at different sessions, along with a tumor bed boost, a total of 54 gray. Patients also receive a combination of chemotherapies that includes carboplatin, cyclophosphamide, together with etoposide and vincristine. And let's look at the outcome of those. So this is just some demographics just to show you that this is a 42 versus 30 versus 34 of the choroid plexus carcinoma, and the rest of the numbers actually showing the completeness of resection. So surgeons managed to get at least 80% resection of the CPP, but the rest were not radiated. Compared to the atypical choroid plexus papilloma, only 11 were radiated and received chemotherapy. CPC or the choroid plexus carcinoma, all of them received that. So let's look at the outcome from that study. So the first line is actually showing you the choroid plexus tumor, and regardless of the completeness of the resection, the outcome or the overall survival, they were all survived, you know, at even 8 years. So let's look at the 5 years, which is the most common reported numbers for most of the tumors. So at 5 years, 100% were alive for the choroid plexus papilloma. For the atypical form, you can say 90% were alive after 5 years. For the choroid plexus carcinoma, it is a 63%. So it's even better than the previous study that I showed you, which was around 2000. Now, when you look at the event-free, so when the tumors start to grow or recur, so with the choroid plexus papilloma, which is the benign form, at 5 years, 92% did not have any recurrence, meaning that the recurrence is around, you know, you can say 5 to 10%, for instance, to your patient, even if you get a complete resection. The atypical form, and remember that this is a mixture of a group who had also received radiation and chemotherapy, but still it's a good outcome. So you can tell them that after five years, 80% has no recurrence, or 20% patient will have a recurrence. So the choroid plexus carcinoma, it's unfortunate, regardless of the treatment that you give, the event-free rate is around 30%. So regardless of any modality of treatment, that's the maximum that got achieved. But remember, those are alive. This is just the event-free. So in conclusion for my talk, you can see that those choroid plexus are rare tumors. They are located within the ventricles most of the time. And in order to have a good success for your procedure, you need to be aware about the details anatomy for the intraventricular compartment, as well as being aware about the paraventricular structures that I showed in my talk. Chemotherapy, as well as radiation therapy, seems to be a good adjunct for a better outcome. And remember that when you go for such tumors, at some point, you should consider the amount of blood loss, what strategy that you will follow to minimize blood loss, and you may also finish this procedure at two stages, considering the aforementioned reasons. Quite challenging and interesting a tumor at the same time, and I hope that you enjoyed this talk. Thank you so much.
Well, excellent. Excellent presentation, Ahmed. You know, listening to you, and this is a question probably, you can get off the screen share, by the way, by clicking on that green.
Yeah.
And I'm sure other neurosurgeons know this, but you have to really have an intricate knowledge of the anatomy. One question I have, Dr. Rotan, of course, was noted for his anatomical studies. Do you find yourself reviewing that before you go into certain cases, Dr. Rotan's drawings?
So Dr. Rotan is a role model, I have to say, for all neurosurgeons training.
Yeah.
I remember during my residency training that Dr. Rotan's book was one of my favorite books. It was challenging, actually, to understand it from the beginning. But as the time goes, each time you open that book, you will see something new. Currently, when I go to read Dr. Rotan's book, it's not similar to the time when I was a resident I have to pay attention to every single word. Right now, because I get used to it, the moment I look at it, I just identify the vessels without looking at his notes from that aspect. I think Dr. Rotan's book is a great book. However, I have also to give the credit for the other anatomist. I have attended a couple of lectures for other anatomists where they actually have shown also good drawings. But in our field and as well as my training, I think Dr. Rotan was one of my favorites, and his books are available. And as you know, recently he passed away, and I'm sorry for that. I attended one of his talks, and when you attend Dr. Rotan's lectures, it's actually a different world.
Really?
Even if you think that you read his book, you understand it, attending his talk is phenomenal.
Oh, so you've been to some of his talks?
I went to one of his talks in Chicago. I think that was a few years ago, maybe. I think around 2012.
Uh-huh.
It is amazing. You will see what you didn't understand in his book.
Really? Wow. Well, when you said, and again, this is a question not from a neurosurgeon, when you said just by retracting you can cause damage,
yeah.
I mean, that shows you how important it is to know the anatomy. And certainly you wouldn't want an unschooled student retracting in the brain for that reason.
Yeah. Absolutely. So, and even the interhemispheric approach, I know that I showed you beautiful pictures, but I remember during my pediatric training, we had a case that we were planning to go interhemispheric approach, and I was so excited from that aspect. But my mentor, he said, you know, it's not as beautiful as it looks in anatomy books. So, you need always to study the superficial cortical and the veins. So sometimes the veins come all together. They are actually within the corridor where you want to go. So sometimes you may have just a 3-centimeter window to retract, because if you also over-retract, those veins will get actually sheared.
Right.
And you need to actually prevent those, because if you get a shearing injury of one of those cortical veins, patient will develop basically a venous infarction.
Wow.
So it's a balance between the amount of retraction you're doing,
right,
what cortex you are retracting, and as you go deep on the surgery, you would like to have a little bit of more retraction, so you have always to watch for those veins. So,
how do you work that? You must have an assistant that knows the anatomy too, or do you direct the retraction in your operations?
So for the retraction, we have a different set of retraction. So you have the Greenberg retractors.
Okay, where so you don't have another person do it. You have a retractor do it.
Those procedures, you need always to have an assistant with you.
Okay.
So right. your assistant can be a resident, a fellow, or another staff.
Right.
Because as you go, you need to have somebody who's retracting for you. But when you operate as a surgeon, and especially right. when you take that responsibility, you have to keep your eyes on the field, right? So over retraction, you know, you have to look at that, even if you are resecting the tumor.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Simon, do you have any questions?
Yes, please. Thank you very much for that wonderful presentation. I liked the joke you were saying about even if you look at the hypothalamus, you can cause some damage, which was amazing. And I was really taken aback by that. My question is regarding the presenting symptoms, and I'm learning, and as you said, that 90% present with intracranial pressure and hemianopsia. But I'm wondering, for comparing children and adults, are they both presenting with tinnitus and dizziness, or are adults more likely to present with that?
Yeah, that's a good question. So choroidal plexus tumors in general are rare in adults. And adults tends to present earlier. So you may not see them presenting with tinnitus, for example, regardless of the location of the tumor, because in adults, the skull is fused. So there is no more space for the brain to accommodate that mass or to accommodate that hydrocephalus. So most of the time, they will present with a headache, nausea, vomiting, before even they present with gait.
I see. And when you're saying vomiting, you mean really vomiting a lot and a big headache?
Yes.
Okay, I see.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I have a question, if I may ask. I know we're asking lots of questions here, but I'm interested in one of the things that Professor Rotten noticed that in his, I don't remember, it was in his presentations, the Rotten collection. How do you manage the eloquent areas of ventricles when you go? Do you use some methods to find those areas and avoid them, or do you use your anatomical knowledge? He said that this is one of the...
Okay. I'm sorry.
This is the area that it has some eloquent areas around it. I mean ventricles. So, how do you manage this in the operations?
Yeah, I think I'm facing a little bit of technical difficulties to understand the question. But if I understood you well, I think you were trying to say when you go inside those ventricles, how you gonna identify those anatomical structures or the essential structures?
How do you find the eloquent, the important anatomical structures that cannot be injured? I mean, this.
Yes.
Do you know the anatomy, or do you use some kind of stimulation to find them?
Oh, I see. So now I hear you. So. Actually, when you are inside the ventricles, and typically speaking, you are inside the ocean, right? You're going there to get a fish, for instance. Mm-hmm. So you have to go and get that fish out, but you need to be aware that behind that fish, always there is a shark, for instance, okay, which mm-hmm. is your fornix, your thalamus. Mm-hmm. So I personally tend, okay, looking at the tumor location, which is the most important, most of the time you will see it within the lateral ventricle or the frontal horn. I personally found most of the time when I go there that the whole area is covered with a tumor. I tend to start resecting the tumor from the front, okay? If it is significantly stuck to that area, after that, I tend to go from the medial aspect, okay, because I want to start from the falx as well as a little bit close to the fornix, because they say by definition, if you get to injure a little bit of the fornix, you still have the other fornix compensating for the memory. Again, sometimes you might need to go kind of circumferential. So once you get a corridor from the medial aspect, then I start to go from the lateral aspect. And let's say that I start to see the thalamus rayed vein. So once I see the thalamus rayed vein, I will know, based on the curvature or that turn that thalamus rayed vein is making, that, oh, this is guiding me to the foramen of Monroe. So I know that anything beyond that forward going to be safe to resect. So you may go ahead and resect more of that tumor in the front that was stuck, and eventually you will be able to see foramen of Monroe. And once you see the foramen of Monroe, trust me, that's going to be, you know, your happy moment, because you get to see most of the important structures. You will know where is each, you know, essential structure that we have spoken about.
Yes, very good. Thank you very much.
Very good. Very good, Ahmed. I'd like to thank you for your excellent presentation. I hope we see a lot more of you.
Thank you so much.
Excellent pictures. Very, very interesting. And we hope to see you. And thank you for taking the time out of your busy schedule.
Thank you so much. And I wish that the rest of the day will be great for you.
Thank you,
Ahmed. Thank you. Okay.